The White Deer by James Thurber. The Magical Forest. If you should walk and wind and wander far enough on one of those afternoons in April, when smoke goes down instead of up, and nearby things sound far away and far things near, you are more than likely to come at last to the enchanted forest that lies between the Moonstone Mines and Centaur's Mountain. You'll know the woods when you are still a long way off, by virtue of a fragrance you can never quite forget and never quite remember. And there'll be a distant bell that causes boys to run and laugh, and girls to stand and tremble. If you pluck one of the 10,000 toadstools that grow in the emerald grass at the edge of the wonderful woods, it will feel as heavy as a hammer in your hand. But if you let it go, it will sail away over the trees like a tiny parachute, trailing black and purple stars. There's even a tale first told by minstrels in the medieval time that rabbits here can tip their heads as men now tip their hats, removing them with their paws and putting them back again. This enchanted forest was once upon a time a part of the kingdom of a mighty monarch named Claude, who had three sons, Thag, Gallo, and Jorn. Thag and Gallo, like their father, King Claude, were great hunters, and when they were not eating or sleeping, they were engaged in the chase. Jorn, the youngest and shortest of the princes, he was only 6 feet tall, was a poet and musician, and when he was not at table or in bed, he was fond of setting his verses to the music of the lyre. He occasionally took part in the hunt when his fathers and brothers insisted, but he was careful to loose his arrows and cast his lances clear of whatever quarry the royal family might be pursuing. Three times in the middle of the century in which they lived, the king and his two older sons had depleted their kingdom of wild life, and three times they had been forced to wait around the castle, restlessly stringing their bows, feathering their arrows, and sharpening their lances, until a new generation of deer and wild boar could come to maturity in the fields and forests. King Claude and Thag and Gallo ate oftener, drank more, and slept longer during these tedious periods of inactivity. And they fell to buffeting and plaguing the members of their retinue, particularly a dwarf named Quando, and the royal wizard, a castle wizard, whose magic consisted chiefly of sleight of hand and juggling, since he was not privy to the secrets of the woods wizards who lived in the enchanted forest. Jorn found these seasons serene, and spent his time singing of a faraway princess who would one day set a perilous labor for each of the princes to perform. He sang that love, not might, would untie the magic knot, or open the mystic lock, or hoodwink the dreadful dragon, or resolve whatever other problem the faraway princess might propose as the key to her heart and hand. Thag and Gallo guffawed at their younger brother's finickery, as they called it, and they would take to tossing Quando the dwarf back and forth in the air as if he were a ball, oblivious of his guttural protests. The older brothers knew better than to put upon Jorn, for he had more than once taken falls from them in wrestling, and he could hold his own at tilting on horseback. One night, when the third period of waiting for the boar and the deer to venture abroad still had 100 moons to run, King Claude told a tale to his sons over his tankards, while Jorn strummed softly on his lyre, and Quando sat in a dark corner of the banquet hall, under a great shield, nursing his scars and bruises. "There is always the enchanted forest to hunt," Prince Thag had growled at supper time, testing the string of a long bow. "There is always the enchanted forest to shun," King Claude had roared, and he went on to tell of how he had once dared to chase a fleet deer in the magic woods with his own father and two brothers, and how they had brought the deer to bay against the sheer wall of Centaur's Mountain, and how, as they had made ready to launch their arrows, the deer had been transformed into a tall, dark young princess, who had been changed into a deer years before by a wicked old woman jealous of the young girl's beauty.
"There we were," went on King Clode. "Your grandfather, King Bode, and his three sons, your Uncle Clune, your Uncle Garth, and myself, feeling like sheep in our chagrin and dismay, or like a mastiff that goes growling boldly into a wolf's den and comes upon a pink-eyed female rabbit. One of those grinning woods wizards came along presently and conjured up a white palfrey for the princess out of thin air, as I remember it, and we rode off to the castle. We gave the princess food and wine and a pillow for her head, and on the following day we set off in full panoply and jingling trappings to carry her to her father, a king whose lands lay far to the north. We jingled through apple blossoms as we started out, for it was May, and we jingled through snowflakes when we neared her ancestral castle. Her father and mother were overjoyed to see their daughter again, and her father, the king, set a series of passable tables in honor of the occasion, although to my taste the wines of the north smack a bit of buckle polish or lance oil, it may be. This was many years ago. Why have you never told, said Thag, this tale before, said Gallo? You were too young, said Clode, for such a tale as might offend the growing heart. Where was I?
This was many years ago, Thag prompted.
Ah, yes, said Clode. Well, your grandfather and your uncles and I were eager to set off for home and the chase. The princess's father was a fellow of small fancies with an indoor turn of mind, given to dawdling over the chessboard even in the keenest hunting weather, drinking a warmish wassail full of aloes or something. We were not to get off as soon or as easy as we thought. There was the infernal custom of the country whereby a rescued princess exercises the privilege of claiming one of her rescuers as her husband. She was a pretty enough grey-eyed minx, but she was fond of the harp and the spinet, with no stomach for the chase, and a way of fluttering up behind a man before he knew it, moving like a cat on velvet. The upshot was that your grandfather rode home alone, and the princess set Clune and Garth and myself each a perilous labor. Clune was to bring back the golden right wing of the great falcon of Ferelaine. Garth, an uncouth varlet at best, though an angel in the saddle, was sent to bring back a drop of blood from the right index finger of 100 kings, an adventure which could not conceivably be concluded within the lifespan of the human being. And I was told off to fetch the princess an enormous diamond, said to lie between the paws of a fearful creature, half dragon and half rock, in the cave of a mountain not many leagues distant.
King Clode filled up 2 tankards from a bowl of wine on the table before him and drank them off.
You were too young to remember, he continued, but a traveller from faraway Ferelaine passed this way some 20 years ago with the news that your Uncle Clune was bested in his struggle with the great falcon, whose left wing, it transpired during the battle, was made of edged and pointed steel. Your Uncle Garth has never been heard from to this day, which is reasonable enough in view of estimates arrived at by my royal recorder, who has figured that it requires 97 years to procure a drop of blood from the right index finger of 100 kings.
While the king filled his tankards again with wine, Prince Jorn strummed a sorrowful song on his lyre.
To make a rather distressing story short, resumed King Clode, the monster I was dispatched to overcome proved to be made of clay and boxwood, so that it was the simplest of tasks to deprive the creature of the enormous diamond clutched between its artificial paws. I delivered the stone to the princess and won her hand in marriage, having already won the fair lady's heart, as even Quando there can see. The king sat back in his great chair and closed his eyes. And the moral of this tale, grumbled Quando, is precisely what? The king opened one eye. The moral of this tale, he said, is precisely never hunt deer in the enchanted forest. Fag and Gallo, who had sat staring at their father through this recital, looked at each other and at the king again. We do not like it, said Fag. Our mother having once been a deer, said Gallo. Jorn spoke for the first time. It was but the illusory and meaningless shape of magic, he said, and returned to his music. The boy has it, roared King Claude. It was, as he says, meaningless magic. He tapped a tankard on the tabletop. Never quite got used to it, though, he admitted at last. Don't suppose a hunting man ever could. There was a long and thoughtful silence before Claude spoke again. She took to her chamber of a mortal malady shortly after Jorn was born and never set foot on the stair again. Perhaps she died of a fall, said Thag. Perhaps she died of a surfeit, said Gallo. Perhaps she died of a look, said Jorn. The king hurled a tankard at the youngest prince, and Jorn caught it in mid-air. Has his mother's quickness and his mother's grace, muttered Claude. He sighed. Well, there is the tale. The royal high chamberlain's voice spoke suddenly behind Claude's chair, and the king started slightly. Must I have men who creep about like cats? Roared Claude. There is a minstrel, sire, the royal high chamberlain said. Then send him in, cried Claude. He'll sing to us of strong men and the chase. I've had enough of sorrow and of love. He glared at Jorn. The minstrel entered softly and sat upon a stool and strummed his lute and sang. He sang of a white deer with the speed of light, a white deer as lovely to look upon as a waterfall in springtime. When the song was done, the king asked, Is this deer as swift as light and as lovely as a waterfall in springtime, a creature of your silly fancy? Or does it have breath and blood, that I and my sons may test its speed and strength? The minstrel sang, The white deer flashes like the light through the forest day and night. Name me the name of this forest, roared the king. The minstrel sang, By night and day the white deer shines betwixt the mountain and the mines. At this, King Claude rose from his chair, upsetting a tankard of red wine that spilled onto the floor. You bound the enchanted forest with your infernal rhyme, he cried. No man of King Claude's household hunts in those accursed woods. The minstrel sang, Too swift for Thag, too quick for Gallo, too strong for young Prince Jorn to follow, but foot of turtle, heart of toad, never shall bespoke of Claude. The king pulled at his long black mustaches, and a light flickered in his eye and went out and flickered again like the light of a firefly. Mayhap, he said at last, this white deer with the speed of light is a true deer. We shall test its vaunted prowess on the morrow. If it be a true deer, I shall hang its head upon the wall and its meat in the larder. If it be a lovely maiden enchanted by some witch's or wizard spell, the daughter of some king whose lands lie to the north or east or south or west, I shall drive my lance and arrow through this foolish minstrel's heart. King Claude pounded a tankard on the table to accent every word of his ominous warning. But when he looked around, the minstrel had disappeared. King Claude frowned. Fellow bore a remarkable resemblance to somebody or other I have encountered somewhere or other, he muttered. If this be a true deer, said Thag, we shall enjoy the greatest chase in history. If this be a true deer, said Gallo, we shall hang the finest venison in all the world. The king's eyes gleamed as he swallowed a great apricot. And if this be a true princess of the royal blood? It was the rumbling voice of Quando the dwarf, speaking from his corner. The king hurled an apple at the dwarf, but Jorn caught it in the air. If this be a true princess of the royal blood, Jorn said, she shall set the sons of Claude each a perilous labor to find the prince most worthy of her heart and hand. At this, to show their strength, Thag caught up a heavy iron from the fireplace and bent it double, and Gallo turned a double handspring down the floor. Jorn watched his brothers and stroked the strings of his lyre. The king tugged at his mustaches, his eyes burning with dreams of the chase. Quando sat in his corner under the shield, watching Claude and Thag and Gallo, and listening to the music of Jorn's lyre. The next morning, as the sun was rising, the king and his three sons, riding on black chargers, entered the enchanted forest, reined in, and gazed about them. Pick not that buttercup, said Claude, pointing a leathery finger at a small flower in the emerald grass, or it will turn to flame and burn your hand. Do not pluck the lichen from that tree, said Thag, or it will turn to blood and stain your hand. Do not touch that white stone there, said Gallo, or it will come alive and bite your hand. There was thunder suddenly from behind the moonstone mines. The sun went out. A flash of lightning made the four horses tremble, and in the darkness all around the king and his sons glimmered a million fireflies. While Claude and his sons gazed at the shimmering dance in amazement, the fireflies changed to snowflakes, which fell softly to the earth and disappeared. The thunder ceased, the clouds parted, and the sun came out.
These constant tricks upon the eye are bad for man's digestion, said King Claude. I shall have no stomach for the finest meat on earth if this false flux of fact and form does not desist.
What's hot is cold, said Thag. What's hard is soft, said Gallo.
What's night is day, said Claude.
Jorn, who had been thinking up a verse during the show of marvels, recited it. What's black is white, what's red is blue, what's dark is light, what's true is true.
Well rhymed, Prince Jorn, said a voice that seemed to come from nowhere, until the king and his sons looked down and saw a woods wizard in a blue robe and a red peaked cap.
Oh, said the king, glaring at the wizard, have I not seen you otherwhere than here?
You have seen me other when than now, said the sorcerer, plucking a pansy and tossing it into the air, where it became a butterfly and fluttered away through the trees.
I have ridden in these woods but once before, said King Claude.
26 years, 25 days, and 24 hours ago, said the wizard.
My father and my brothers and I pursued a deer, said Claude, which, against the wall of Centaur's Mountain, underwent a marvelous and mortifying metamorphosis. I am a little touchy on the topic, too, so do not turn your tongue to taunts.
He does not turn his tongue, said Jorn. He twists your own to M's and T's. And W's, said the wizard, as you shall see.
Try twice that trick on Claude, said the king with great dignity, my mousy man of magic, and we will rid these wizards of wizards.
King Claude made a royal gesture of arrogance, authority, and austerity, while his son stared at him in astonishment.
"You speak magic words, O Claude," said the wizard smugly, removing his cap and bowing deeply. "And now may I be of service to you and the Princess Thag and Gallo and Jorn? May I show you the barking tree or the musical mud or the wingless birds?"
The king grimaced at this list of wonders, and Prince Jorn answered the wizard. "My father seeks the white deer," he said, "the white deer swift as light and lovely as a waterfall in springtime." The wizard bowed again and flung his cap in the air.
"What goes up must not come down," he said.
And the cap, swinging slowly like a bell, sailed silently over the trees, rising higher and higher, until finally it could be seen no more.
"What comes down must go up," said the wizard,
and he wiggled three fingers of his left hand toward the ground. Suddenly the snowflakes that had melted and vanished began to rise from the earth, and when they were as high as the wizard's heart, they changed into 1,000,000 fireflies. The king and his sons watched in wonder, and for a moment, 4 horses and 4 men were as still as statues in amazement. For through the glow and glimmer and gleam, there suddenly flashed a white deer, as swift as light and as lovely as a waterfall in springtime.
"Hi, yellow!" cried the king, and he and his sons were off in pursuit, the sparks from their horses' hoofs joining in the dance of the fireflies. The white deer flashed through the green forest, and the king and his sons followed, past the barking tree, across the musical mud, in and out of a flock of wingless birds. On and on went the chase, until the sun began to set, and long, strange shadows fell. The white deer led its pursuers through a silver swamp and a bronze bog and a golden glade, its speed still swift as light. It shot like an arrow through a fiery fen and over a misty moor. It climbed a ruby ridge, flung across a valley of violets, and sped along the pearly path leading to the myriad mazes of the Moonstone Mines. 20 hoofs thundered hotly through a haunted hollow of spectral sycamores hung with lighted lanterns, and past a turquoise tarn and along an avenue of asphodel that turned and twisted down a dark descent which led at last to a pale and perilous plain. The setting sun sank into the sea, 7 stars shone suddenly in the sky, and the white deer's dreadful day was done, its race was run, for now it stood, silent and still and shivering, under the mighty crag called Centaur's Mountain. King Claude and the princes Thag and Gallo prepared to loose their arrows, and Jorn closed his eyes against the sight. When he opened them a moment later, the royal huntsmen had dropped their bows and arrows to the earth to stare not at a deer at bay, but at a tall and dark and youthful maiden, a veritable princess, clad in a long white satin robe, the sparkle of jewels in her hair, golden sandals upon her feet, her red lips parted prettily, her dark eyes shining. 4 horses raised 8 ears in sharp surprise, 3 princes fell upon their knees at the maiden's feet, and the king glowered and tugged at his mustaches.
"As royal a run as any king could know," he growled, "and it ends as always in vanished venison and a lovely lady to carry to her kingdom. Pray God her father has a decent taste in wines."
But when young Jorn, who alone of the princes could find his tongue, asked the maiden to name her name and tell her kingdom, she could only shake her head and say she did not know. King Claude sighed.
"Swing her to your saddle, Jorn," he said, "and we will serve her at our table in another way than I had hoped. Make haste before that wicked woods wizard shows up to make sport of us all."
Prince Jorn lifted the princess to his saddle, and the jingle of the harness bells and buckles sounded like merry laughter in King Claude's ears as he whirled his horse about, and they began the long ride home across the pale and perilous plain, up the dark descent, along the avenue of Asphodel, past the turquoise tarn, through the haunted hollow of spectral sycamores hung with lighted lanterns, in and out of the myriad mazes of the moonstone mines, along the pearly path, across the valley of violets, over the ruby ridge and the misty moor, through the fiery fen and the golden glade and the bronze bog and the silver swamp, in and out of the flock of wingless birds, across the musical mud, past the barking tree, and through the green forest and the shimmering fireflies, and out at last upon the open road that led straight to the castle. The Lost Princess. The next morning, the princess sat in an eastern room and watched the sunlight falling through slits and circles in the ancient castle wall, making small bright patterns on the cold stone floor. The royal wizard, a wizard, as we have said, of meager devices, juggled 7 silver spheres for the entertainment of the princess, while Quando sat in the corner and watched first the silver spheres and then the dark, bewildered eyes of the lovely maiden. She had lain awake most of the night, trying in vain to remember her name and the name of her father. On the floor at her feet, the royal recorder sat cross-legged, chanting the names of kings from a ponderous ledger in the hope that one of them might light a light in the lady's eyes. He had reached the P's and droned steadily on, Pack, Pardo, Pyrel, Pent, Peril, Pio, Piligro, Pilth, Podo, Polonil, Puggy. At the name Puggy, the princess started slightly, but only because the royal wizard had dropped one of the silver spheres. Quando picked it up and tossed it back to him. The royal recorder made a series of sounds with his tongue and teeth. King Puggy, he said disapprovingly, is the most disreputable king in the whole registry of kings. He lives in a ruined castle on a hill with his 7 madcap daughters. The old king's wife died of a fit of shrieks when all the princesses were very young. Now Puggy and his 7 maids live all alone, wreaking every kind of hob and havoc on their hill, rolling boulders down on passers-by, turning rivers from their normal course, stealing gems and silks from caravans so they can dress in gaudy masquerade and play their wild and eerie games by jack-o'-lantern light. The royal recorder raised his hands and shook his head. Every night is Halloween on Puggy's Hill. The princess frowned and turned a little pale. The royal recorder sighed again and read more names, glancing at the princess after every name. But she gave no sign of recognition. He ran on through 20 Q's and 30 R's and 40 S's and 10 T's and 5 U's and 2 V's and 13 W's and 90 X's and 56 Y's and came at last to the Z's. Zah, he said, and the princess jumped in her chair, but only because the royal wizard had dropped another silver sphere. Quando tossed it back to him, and the juggling and the droning continued. Zezo, Zat, Zawazaw, Zav, Zax, Zay, Zazir, Zazuno, Ziz, chanted the recorder. And he closed the record of royalty with a dusty thump, shook his head sadly, and stood up. The wizard let the silver spheres drop into a wide pocket of his long robe. Quando gazed softly at the princess.
I have a memory of trees and fields, and a memory of nothing more, she sighed.
This presents a problem for a practitioner of physic, said the royal recorder, but unhappily the royal physician is quite ill of some mysterious malady and has given orders that he must not be disturbed.
The princess studied with troubled eyes a pattern of crenellated shadow on the floor.
There is, to be sure, the royal clockmaker.
He has made several shrewd surmises in his time. Tocco, the clockmaker, he added, was formerly the royal astronomer.
The princess took her kerchief and wiped a ledger smudge from the royal recorder's cheek.
Why is Tocco no longer the royal astronomer? She asked.
He got so old he could not see the planets very well, or even the moon, or even the sun, said the recorder. His constant reports that everything was going out alarmed King Claude, who must have light to hunt by, as you know, and no offense intended.
The princess smiled faintly. The recorder went on.
Let me have men in my towers who bring me news of bright sun and stars, King Claude then cried. So Tocco was set to making clocks and chimes and sundials, and a younger man named Paz now scans the skies. He has invented rose-colored lenses for his telescope, so even the palest moon and coldest star turn red and deep, and it is thus reported to the king. Let us visit the shadowy shop of ancient Tocco and hear what we may hear.
They found Tocco in his shop, carving a legend on a sundial. After this brief light, the unending dark. The old man's eyes were so dim and 100 clocks ticked and chimed so loudly that he was not aware of his visitors. The princess read the legend carved on another sundial. It is darker than you think. And on a third, this little light, and then the night. The royal recorder tapped the ancient clockmaker on his shoulder, and Tocco looked up with pale and misty eyes.
I bring a nameless princess, said the royal recorder, who has a memory of trees and fields and a memory of nothing more.
He cupped his hand close to the old man's ear and told the tale of the white deer and of how it had been transformed into a tall and dark and lovely princess at the foot of Centaur's Mountain, and of how he had read out all the names of kings in the royal register without lighting a light in the eyes of the princess.
You were ever a man of shrewd surmises and gifted guesses, concluded the royal recorder. What say you ails the lady?
The clockmaker waved the long, thin fingers of one hand.
Send the lady to walk in the gardens, he said, where the silver fountains play, the while I hazard a few hazards as to what has happened to her head.
The hands of the 100 clocks pointed to noon, but the clocks chimed 8 and 6 and 9 and 4 and all the other hours but 12.
Maidens have a strange effect on clocks, said Tocco. Causing them to strike too little or too long, making a travesty of time.
The royal recorder led the princess to the door and showed her the gardens where the silver fountains played, and he watched her until she moved among them, lovely but forlorn, beyond the sound of clocks and voices.
Perhaps she had a fall and struck a stone, said the recorder, and in this wise lost her memory.
The old man shook his head.
Perhaps she drank a potion or a philter, said the recorder, and in this wise lost her memory.
The old man shook his head again and said,
You asked me to assume assumptions, and you assume assumptions of your own.
The recorder said that he was sorry, and listened in silence while the old man spoke.
I mind a tale my father told 100 years ago or thereabouts, said Tocco. A marvelous tale of a true deer who befriended a woods wizard. It seems this woods wizard in the olden time had a fall or drank a potion or a philter and tumbled senseless in a stream in April when streams are swift and strong. The tale tells how a passing deer plucked
plucked the senseless wizard from the stream and saved his life. In return for this good and timely deed, he gave the deer the power of changing to a princess, tall and dark and lovely, in the event that hunters pressed it hard and there was nowhere to flee, as when a deer is brought to bay at Centaur's Mountain.
The recorder's eyes grew large and round, and his mouth fell open. In the pause that followed, the 100 clocks, whose hands pointed to 11 minutes after noon, struck 13 times. When the chiming ceased, the recorder spoke.
"Do you mean to tell me, Tocco, that this princess is in all, save shape and semblance, a true deer, and not a princess of the royal blood?" "In due course," pursued the old man, "the deer I speak of in the ancient time was hotly pressed by some hobbledehoy of the region, unaccountably skillful in the saddle, and brought to bay against a crag too steep to climb. As the hunter raised his bow, the panting, wild-eyed deer became before his goggling eyes a princess in all seeming, tall and dark and lovely. The hobbledehoy turned white and red and blue and rode off as fast as his spent horse could travel, leaving his bow and arrow on the ground. The deer in maiden's guise made its way to the cave of the woods wizard it had befriended and put to him a quavering question. How could it remain a maiden and live in the manner of a maiden? The wizard, out of his old gratitude, gave the deer the power of remaining a maiden in shape and semblance until such time as love should fail her thrice. If love should fail her thrice, then she must resume her true form forever and forever, come what may. The first to love her was a poet, the second was a minstrel, the third was a knight. Each in his turn discovered her true nature, and each in his turn failed of his love. For who can love a lady who is in reality a deer?
There was, for a long moment, only the ticking of the clocks and the faint sound of the fountains. "And in the end," asked the royal recorder, "when love had failed her thrice?"
"In the end, when love had failed her thrice," Tocco said, "she was instantly changed back into her true and proper form. A fortnight later, she was hard-pressed by the same hobbledehoy who had pursued her before. This time, his arrow found her heart."
The clocks, all of a sudden, struck 7.
"Is this a truth, you tell me?"
demanded the recorder.
"The white deer of my father's time knew not her name, for wild deer have no names. She had a memory of trees and fields, and a memory of nothing more,"
old Tocco said.
"How can I tell this tale to Claude, the proudest hunter of his day?"
the royal recorder cried.
"I beg you, Tocco, doubt your doubts and hope some hopes. This princess may be real."
The old man coughed.
"Against the may, the could be, and the should, folly it is to balance doubt or hope. I know the symbols, signs, and symptoms of 1,000 spells. Sorceries run in cycles."
Neither the old man nor the younger observed a dark form in a gloomy corner of the shop. It was the squatty figure of Quando, who had crept in unnoticed. His eyes were closed that they might not sparkle and be seen, but he was not asleep. The royal recorder turned without a word, opened the heavy oaken door, and went out. He watched the lovely princess walk toward him, the sparkle of jewels in her hair, golden sandals on her feet, and he marveled that a deer, if this was indeed a deer, could take so perfectly the shining semblance of a lady of royal blood. The royal recorder wondered if he could truly love a lady who might at this time or that, depending on the special spell that held her in enchantment, begin to nibble at the young leaves on the trees. He decided with a sigh and a shake of his head that he could not, and made a little note to this effect in the archives of his heart. There were question marks in the dark eyes of the nameless maid, but the royal recorder shook his head and looked away and sighed. The old man moaned and maundered, murmured, muttered, mumbled odds of this and ends of that, bits and pieces, shreds and edges, full of ifs and whens and theres and thens, amounting in the end and all to 6 times less than nothing. He bowed and sighed and bowed again, and watched the princess cross the grass like summer rain and vanish through a portal.